future our people deserve.
What does Janine think is in that box, Caleb?
I don't know, but she's testing Divergence. Searching for the one who can open it.
Find them. Every last one of them.
Janine's never gonna stop coming after us. It's time we fight back.
We don't have the numbers.
We will.
This is factionless? This is insane.
Janine claims you're all dangerous insurgents. If we were to combine forces, we'd be unstoppable.
Well, thank you guys so much for being here. Everyone excited to see Insurgent? Let you get settled, Theo, and get comfortable.
Take a breather. Get comfy. My trousers.
Well, it's so great to see you two together again on screen. Love the film. I know everyone's excited to see it. What's your favorite part of playing Tris and Theo?
The t-shirts, I think.
They're so tight.
Yeah. I would say, Four is a kind of, you know, complex, quiet man, and the ability to, you know, hopefully develop him as a character through the movies, and someone who, you know, wears his masculinity lightly. I kind of like the idea of him being kind of stepping back from the crowd.
I really love that Tris externally projects a certain bravery and a certain courage, but internally struggles with herself and her own confidence and her own self-worth and her own self-kindness. And I think that's something that we can all relate to, and I find that really fascinating in her.
There were so many great scenes in the movie. I was on the edge of my seat the entire time with all the action scenes. What was your favorite one to film?
The running is always nice. No. I guess maybe the house sequence was really neat because there's a lot of wire work involved and you don't often get to do that, those types of stunts.
The bit on the trailer where he jumps across the train was kind of funny because people keep saying to me, so was that wires that, you know, you were on wires, right? I'm like, no, I did it myself. I'm like, no, you couldn't do that, you loser. But yeah, no, so they just basically set up a piece of track and then I had to jump across it. It's not a great story, thinking about it.
So you guys did do some, you did do some of your own stunts on set though, yeah? That's very impressive.
Yeah, it's stunts are fun to do. You're sort of guaranteed safety and they're exhilarating. You get a free adrenaline rush without much danger involved.
What have you guys learned from working together on the Divergent franchise? From each other?
Learn a lot about British culture.
Such as?
I don't know.
Can you do a British accent?
My British accent sounds like Nanny McPhee. It's not a realistic British accent.
What have I learned from Shay? self-love. many things. You know, the nice thing about doing more than one film is that you get to know someone over a period of time, and you can kind of become proper friends instead of kind of, you know, because often when you do a film, you're kind of buddies quite quickly, you're fast friends. But doing this, you get to know people, meet her friends and family. I don't know why I looked over there, but hey, yeah. So that's nice.
Well, that was actually a perfect lead into my next question, so thank you for that, Theo. I was going to say you have great chemistry on screen, and was it easier the second time around because you already know each other and have that rapport together?
Yeah, I mean, I think that there's something to be said about what Theo just mentioned, which is when you have the luxury of doing a few films with someone, you do get to know them better and better, and your sense of trust for that person, your sense of respect for that person grows. And that definitely translates to our characters. You can obviously, if you don't have multiple films with someone, fake that and pretend that. But it is nice when you genuinely do respect the person that you're acting alongside.
Yeah, we kind of have a bit of a shorthand as well, because you do a second film and you've kind of gone through the first and learned some things from the first movie. So when, you know, when a scene wasn't feeling right or it wasn't sitting well, we could look at each other to say, you know, how should we fix this kind of thing.
It becomes teamwork, which is really nice.
You're also reteamed in this movie with Ansel Elgort, who we saw you with in Fault of Our Stars. In this movie, you're siblings. Do you prefer to play a couple or brother and sister? Or is it weird to switch?
At the same time, you like to do both.
Being a sibling and a lover. Kissing my brother. No, I mean, that's sort of the beauty of being an actor, is you get to jump into different roles and different shoes, wear different hats, and then take them off at the end of the day and try on another one.
Now, if either of you could create your own faction, what would you name it, and what sort of people would be in it?
Where is this broadcasting?
Where's what?
Well, what's the watershed? Is it like past midnight or something? Sorry. No, I was going to say something weird and dark.
Go ahead, say it. We're live on the internet, yeah. So.
Just one long beep.
you can curse.
What would, can I?
Yeah, you can.
But now I'm scared to.
The pressure.
No pressure.
Of cursing.
Well, I don't know. What would...
Or you could choose one that's already existing. I just thought you've probably been asked that before, and it might be fun to create your own. But you could pick one that they already have.
A music faction?
Yeah, a music faction. Mm. Music and food faction.
That sounds good to me. Sign me up.
Yeah.
No,
we just did, literally.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah, it's downstairs.
What's the initiation? No, I was reading that you actually were shooting guns that fired in this movie, which didn't happen in the first one. Is that true?
Yeah, the first film were sort of plastic prototypes, and these ones were real guns that they manipulated to look like futuristic fancy guns, but you would just shoot blanks.
So you're shooting real guns, you're throwing knives. Do you guys have any other secret talents that we don't know about?
You're pretty proficient with a bow and arrow, right?
Yes. secret talents.
I don't know that we could share them, though, because then they wouldn't be a secret.
Oh, I see. They're very secretive. Well, Insurgent is definitely darker than Divergent was. How did you guys keep it light on set during your downtime? Because this was a different mood to me than the last one, and it was different themes and a little darker.
It was similar. We usually keep it pretty light, and, you know, you need to be able to... kind of mess around when you can, but then I feel like we're both quite good at taking it seriously, because in a funny way you could quite easily slip, you know, you're doing a second film and you've already done the first one, you could slip back, well, not back into anything, but you could take your foot off the gas a bit, but we're quite good at not doing that and taking everything, trying to kind of push everything as far as we can
most of the time.
Most of the time. Yeah.
Any practical jokes on set? I feel like you two have a pretty good sense of humor. I could definitely see some pranks being played.
There actually weren't many pranks. There weren't any pranks on this movie. The first movie, there was a few.
I set Shay's trailer alight. She didn't find very funny.
I thought it was hilarious. The transportation department didn't. but we did joke around and whatnot. It's just more, we had like a very witty cast. I feel like a lot of the people in this cast have really great senses of humor and are just very
Did you get to enjoy Atlanta at all during your downtime or get to do anything fun there?
Yeah, absolutely. The nice thing about filming in Atlanta is it didn't get dark until like 9:30 at night. And so when we would wrap, there were many times that we'd go stand up paddleboarding after work or hiking or kayaking or rock climbing, which was fun. There's a lot of outdoor activities to involve yourself in.
Very cool. So at Cambio, we're all about Built by Girls, which is about empowering strong, smart young women. And Tris is a great role model for girls. So I was wondering, is it important to you to take strong female characters like that people can look up to, especially young girls?
I guess after the fact, yes. But when I read a script, that's not something that's necessarily controlling or lending to my choice of roles. Because in a way, like acting is just an art form, you know, and as an artist, you kind of want to try everything and dive into every different character. But looking back on Tris and recognizing how empowering she is, it's exciting to share that with others.
Probably a nice bonus, if you will, then.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
Who are your own role models in real life?
Theo James.
He's amazing.
Probably, you know, family's a big one.
Yeah.
You know, parents.
Friends, close friends.
I acting-wise, I liked, you know, Newman was always a cool dude. And Sean Connery, you know, being British, those early Sean Connery Bonds were kind of a seminal part of my upbringing. Yeah, upbringing.
I can see you doing
lesson
Bond one day.
Is how to speak like Sean. Terrible.
Did you just snort? Love that. You actually turned down the franchise at first, right? Because you didn't want to do a franchise, correct? So now that we're into the second movie, how has your life changed since signing on for this, for both of you?
Wonderfully. Nothing has really... I'm speaking for myself, but it's busier. A lot busier, but other than that, much hasn't changed at all. Because at the end of the day, my lifestyle hasn't changed, my friends haven't changed, who I am hasn't changed. So
you're still able to go out and not get mobbed all the time, and you can, you know, go to the grocery store and sweats and all that kind of thing.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think if you, you're the same person, and there are probably sometimes situations that you might not. You know, you might decide to not go, do or go into, but no, generally you're the same person, so it doesn't really change.
Now, I know Shay is a big fan of natural herbs and remedies and all that sort of thing. Did she give you anything on set or any advice? Or I read that you once gave a co-star deodorant that you made naturally, so just wondering if
like
she imparted
hint,
anything on you, any wisdom or tokens.
Who
or
did you give deodorant
herbs?
I see.
She gave it to Ansel on set of Pot of Our Stars, right? So how about you, Theo? Did you get deodorant or anything from Shay?
No, luckily not that. Yeah, can you imagine that or toothpaste?
Theo wears deodorant, so I don't need to give that to him.
Smooth Moves was a good tip from Shay.
When did I get you Smooth Move?
On set once.
Really?
Yeah. What is that for people who may not know?
It's a natural laxative.
Oh, okay. Keeping everything moving on set, making sure everything's regular and on time. That's hilarious. I think we're going to open it up for audience questions soon, but I've noticed that you both aren't on social media or your Twitter isn't super active. Why are you guys not into that?
It takes a lot of time, I think, to do that.
Too busy.
Well, and also... you want to speak? I don't know.
I think we'd probably both, as you can tell, probably say inappropriate things anyway, and we get in trouble for it.
Yeah.
But no, it's like you want to keep a bit of a boundary, and different strokes is, you know, for different folks. But
that was a good one. Different strokes for different folks.
But you, it's nice sometimes to keep a boundary between work and your kind of home life. Yeah.
I understand. I imagine that everybody watching this live streamed on the internet right now is super excited because we don't always get to see you guys and hear from you guys, and it's live, and this is exciting. So I think we're going to open it up to some audience questions. I'm sure there's lots of things that people want to know. So does anybody have questions for Theo and Shay? They'll bring you the microphone.
Quickly.
We'll throw you one.
Hi, guys. I really love Divergent so much. You guys are great. Anyway, if life was really like Divergent, would you consider your character's decision rational?
In the second film or in the first film?
I'm sorry, in making a change. In both films, I guess.
Do you think the choices they make are rational? Yeah, I think so. I mean, Tris is a bit different, isn't she? I don't want to speak for you, but in the second movie, she is motivated by the death of her parents, so she's quite impulsive and she wants revenge. So in a way, for my characters trying to kind of stop that and kind of protect her from that impulsivity, because that's one thing that makes her, you know, very great and unique, but at the same time, she's kind of self-destructive. I think the other theme with Tris is this kind of idea of self-sacrifice. You know, it's this idea that she, which kind of the end of the final book always made sense to me, because her whole story is one of sacrificing herself for the good of others.
Hi, I'm Ivana. I love the Divergence books. I was wondering, when I saw the trailer, I wasn't too sure about what the box was. How was that incorporated in the movie? And, like, how was acting it out? Because I know, do you guys draw a lot of your inspiration for the characters from the books? Or, like, how to go about things?
That's a great question. I mean, the first movie, I think, followed the book a little bit more closely. And the second film, the book, there was simply so much storyline, so much plot. For the sake of creating something visually, they had to rearrange some things, some ideas, and incorporate new ideas. And the box was a way to sort of incorporate the essence of the book while also retaining some visual integrity and translating it to the screen. And as far as you said, the second question was... Oh, yeah, inspiration. Mm. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean,
that's the basis of for definitely the character. And, you know, you have to, once you start, you have to let go a little bit and trust your own instincts. But yeah, I mean.
And you want to honor Veronica Roth also, because she's the one who really created this world. And so hopefully if we can incorporate a little bit of ourselves while also ensuring that the characters she created, are real and feel very honest, then hopefully we can do that. Yeah.
Any other questions from the audience?
Yes, a mystery lingers from Downton Abbey. Were you, was Mr. Pamuk poisoned?
No, I just think he... you know, he hit a peak so hard that he never came back from it.
Literally.
Hi. I was just wondering how you prepared for the roles of Tris and Four in terms of acting methods, and, like, how did that vary between films?
I mean, for me, acting method-wise, I don't really know much about specific acting methods. It's more about knowing who the character is by reading, I mean, in this case, the book and the script, and hearing others' opinions of her, while also finding the shades of that particular character within yourself. And then, obviously, learning your lines, showing up, and really surrendering to the person that you're acting in front of, or if you're doing a scene by yourself, surrendering to the events that surround you and not forcing anything, just being a professional listener and allowing emotions to be evoked based on the reality of the moment versus a preconceived notion.
I think I always start with your instinct, similarly, how you perceive the character. For him, I thought of someone who was very watchful, but not necessarily, he chose very specifically when to kind of communicate or speak his mind. So you were kind of always, especially in the first movie, not 100% sure of what he was thinking. So, and then kind of developing that idea, someone who, again, as I said before, is kind of back from the crowd, and isn't the first to speak. And then in this second film, it was the idea of someone who kind of falls in love and is softening to that, and he has something to lose, whereas he didn't have anything to lose before.
Speaking of books and TV shows, what do you guys like to read or watch or listen to in your downtime? You said music was a faction and you're a big reader, so just curious what's on your guys' Kindle or iPod or Netflix?
Yeah, a lot. What am I listening to at the moment? I saw that, which I'm a bit late to. I know everyone's seen it. I saw that documentary, Searching for Sugar Man. No,
that was good. Really good, too.
That's very good, yeah. No, Searching for Sugar Man, and he's like this, yeah. I don't know if anyone's heard of that already. I'm sure I've read it, seen it. It's very good, and the music's good. So I'd recommend it, yeah.
How about you?
Listening to you right now. There's this European artist named Asaf Avidan. He's incredible. Someone recently introduced him to me, and he's just got such a unique voice and way of making music.
I saw the clip of you guys being asked to sing Taylor Swift, and that was hilarious. So good job on those.
Did we sing it?
You needed a line, and then you had it, and you were great. And you kind of had it too, but it was good.
You had it better than I did.
I thought you were saying I embarrassed myself. Basically.
No. Entertaining, very entertaining. Any other audience questions? Looks like we have one.
Hi, hello. Just wanted to ask, what was the toughest scene that you had to do that was physically demanding or that you had to face your fear?
Truth serum?
Yes. That was it.
J'agree. Yeah, because we came to the scene and we didn't exactly know how. It was different, basically, than how Shay and I had visualized it in our head. In the book, they're kind of...
The location of it.
Location of it, exactly, yeah. And the way they were kind of physically there. So we kind of had to figure out how the truth serum would affect you. And because it's a tricky thing, because we didn't want to go too hard, because then we look like we're having kind of epileptic fits. But then if you don't do enough, you know, there's no stakes and you just kind of look like you're going to pass out. So that was kind of interesting. Shailene?
It was definitely the most challenging scene and also sort of gratifying in a way once we got through it. Not gratifying, but it was nice to finally find what the balance would be.
Looks like we have another couple questions.
We have time for one more question.
Did you like filming the first movie or the second movie more?
More one over the other. They were both good for different reasons and different, completely different experiences. The first film was shot in Chicago in the winter, so it was very cold. We were in dark environments and abandoned warehouses. And then the second film was in Atlanta in the summer. It was hot and there was fireflies. And we were filming a lot of it outdoors versus in a dark landscape. So they're vastly different in exterior, and as far as the storylines were very different, the directors were different, the crews were different. So I don't know that one was necessarily better than the other. I think Atlanta was easier in a lot of ways, but I don't know that both experiences were good on their own. Would you agree?
Yeah, I'd say Atlanta was a little bit easier in that way, but they both had their own challenges. And, you know, when we got to set, we said this a couple of times, but when we got to set, we were thinking that it would be, you know, like that. And then we were, i.e. getting back into our characters, but then we were in the middle of the Amity world, which is a big field. We had a new director wearing new clothes, and we had a minute of going kind of, who the fuck are these people, basically. And then we click back in kind of on the last day of filming. No, I'm kidding.
The last scene.
Well, we just got you to curse, so I think on that, we're good for the day. So thank you so much to Shay and Theo for joining us. Everyone, make sure to go see Insurgent March 20th in theaters. It's amazing. And thank you guys so much for being here. And thanks for all the questions.
Thanks for coming.
Yeah.
No,
we just did, literally.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah, it's downstairs.
What's the initiation? No, I was reading that you actually were shooting guns that fired in this movie, which didn't happen in the first one. Is that true?
Yeah, the first film were sort of plastic prototypes, and this one, these ones were real guns that they manipulated to look like futuristic fancy guns, but you would just shoot blanks.
So you're shooting real guns, you're throwing knives. Do you guys have any other secret talents that we don't know about?
You're pretty proficient with a bow and arrow, right?
Ooh.
Yes. secret talents.
I don't know that we could share them, though, because then they wouldn't be a secret.
Oh, I see, I see. They're very secretive. Well, Insurgent is definitely darker than Divergent was. How did you guys keep it light on set during your downtime? Because this was a different mood to me than the last one, and it was different themes and a little darker.
Yeah, but similar. We usually keep it pretty light, and, you know, you need to be able to... kind of mess around when you can, but then I feel like we're both quite good at taking it seriously, because in a funny way, you could quite easily slip, you know, you're doing a second film and you've already done the first one, you kind of, you could slip back, well, not back into anything, but you could take your foot off the gas a bit, but we're quite good at not doing that and taking everything, trying to kind of push everything as far as we can.
Most of the time.
Most of the time, yeah.
Any practical jokes on set? I feel like you two have a pretty good sense of humor. I could definitely see some pranks being played.
There actually weren't many pranks. There weren't any pranks on this movie. The first movie, there was a few.
I set Shay's trailer alight. She didn't find very funny.
I thought it was hilarious. The transportation department didn't find it very funny. But we did joke around and whatnot. It's just more, we had like a very witty cast. I feel like a lot of the people in this cast have really great senses of humor and are just very...
Did you get to enjoy Atlanta at all during your downtime or get to do anything fun there?
Yeah, absolutely. The nice thing about filming in Atlanta is it didn't get dark until like 9:30 at night. And so when we would wrap, there were many times that we'd go stand up paddleboarding after work or hiking or kayaking or rock climbing, which was fun. There's a lot of outdoor activities to involve yourself in.
Very cool. So at Cambio, we're all about Built by Girls, which is about empowering strong, smart young women. And Tris is a great role model for girls. So I was wondering, is it important to you to take strong female characters like that that people can look up to, especially young girls?
I guess after the fact, yes. But when I read a script, that's not something that's necessarily controlling or lending to my choice of roles, because in a way... like acting is just an art form, you know, and as an artist, you kind of want to try everything and dive into every different character. But looking back on Tris and recognizing how empowering she is, it's exciting to share that with others.
Probably a nice bonus, if you will. Then.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
Who are your own role models in real life?
Theo James.
He's amazing.
Probably, you know, family's a big one.
Yeah.
You know, parents.
Friends, close friends.
I liked, you know, Newman was always a cool dude. And Sean Connery, you know, being British, those early Sean Connery Bonds were kind of a seminal part of my upbringing. Yeah, upbringing.
I can see you
first
doing
lesson
one day.
Is how to speak like Sean. Terrible.
Did you just snort? Love that. You actually turned down the franchise at first, right? Because you didn't want to do a franchise, correct? So now that we're into the second movie, how has your life changed since signing on for this?
Future our people deserve.
What does Janine think is in that box, Caleb?
I don't know, but she's testing Divergence. Searching for the one who can open it.
Find them. Every last one of them.
Janine's never gonna stop coming after us. It's time we fight back.
We don't have the numbers.
We will.
This is factionless? This is insane.
Janine claimed you're all dangerous insurgents.
If
If we were to combine forces, we'd be unstoppable. Stop. I can't let anyone else die because of me.
Chris, help me!
Perfect subject.
You need to be strong. You're brave. She's the one.
This is the only chance we have to rescue a little civilization we have left.
Dark times call for extreme measures. Let's begin. I'm not gonna fight you.
Of course you're not. You're gonna fight you.
Hello. Well, thank you guys so much for being here. Everyone excited to see Insurgent? Let you get settled, Theo, and get comfortable.
Take a breather. Take my shoes off, get comfy, my trousers.
Well, it's so great to see you two together again on screen. Love the film. I know everyone's excited to see it. What's your favorite part of playing Tris and Theo?
The t-shirts, I think.
They're so tight.
Yeah. I would say, for me, I would say Four is a kind of, you know, complex, quiet man, and the ability to, you know, hopefully develop him as a character through the movies, and someone who, you know, wears his masculinity lightly. I kind of like the idea of him being kind of stepping back from the crowd.
I really love that Tris externally projects a certain bravery and a certain courage, but internally struggles with herself and her own confidence and her own self-worth and her own self-kindness. And I think that's something that we can all relate to, and I find that really fascinating in her.
There were so many great scenes in the movie. I was on the edge of my seat the entire time with all the action scenes. What was your favorite one to film?
The running is always nice. No. I guess maybe the house sequence was really neat because there's a lot of wire work involved and you don't often get to do that, those types of stunts.
Hi, I'm Ivana. I love the Divergence books. I was wondering, when I saw the trailer, I wasn't too sure about what the box was. How was that incorporated in the movie? And like, how was acting it out? Because I know, do you guys draw a lot of your inspiration for the characters from the books, or like how to go about things?
That's a great question. I mean, the first movie I think followed the book a little bit more closely, and the second film, the book, there was simply so much storyline, so much plot, for the sake of creating something visually, they had to rearrange some things, some ideas, and incorporate new ideas. And the box was a way to sort of incorporate the essence of the book while also retaining some visual integrity and translating it to the screen. And as far as you said, the second question was oh yeah, inspiration. Mm. Yeah, absolutely. I mean,
that's the basis of definitely the character. And, you know, you have to, once you start, you have to let go a little bit and trust your own instincts. But yeah, I mean.
And you want to honor Veronica Roth also, because she's the one who really created this world. And so hopefully if we can incorporate a little bit of ourselves while also ensuring that the characters she created are real and feel very honest, then hopefully we can do that. Yeah.
Any other questions from the audience?
Yes, a mystery lingers from Downton Abbey. Was Mr. Kamook poisoned?
No, I just think he, you know, he hit a peak so hard that he never came back from it.
Literally.
Hi. I was just wondering how you prepared for the roles of Tris and Four in terms of acting methods, and like how did that vary between films?
I mean, for me, acting method-wise, I don't really know much about specific acting methods. It's more about knowing who the character is by reading, I mean, in this case, the book and the script, and hearing others' opinions of her, while also finding the shades of that particular character within yourself. And then, obviously, learning your lines, showing up, and really surrendering to the person that you're acting in front of, and or if you're doing a scene by yourself, surrendering to the events that surround you and not forcing anything, just being a professional listener and allowing emotions to be evoked based on the reality of the moment versus a preconceived notion.
I think I always start with what your instincts similarly, how you perceive the character. For him, I thought of someone who was very watchful, but not necessarily, he chose very specifically when to kind of communicate or speak his mind. So you were kind of always, especially in the first movie, not 100% sure of what he was thinking. So, and then kind of developing that idea, someone who, again, as I said before, is kind of back from the crowd and isn't the first to speak. And then in this second film, it was the idea of someone who kind of falls in love and is softening to that, and he has something to lose, whereas he didn't have anything to lose before.
Speaking of books and TV shows, what do you guys like to read or watch for both of you?
Wonderfully, nothing has really... I'm speaking for myself, but it's busier, a lot busier. But other than that, much hasn't changed at all, because at the end of the day, like, my lifestyle hasn't changed, my friends haven't changed, my who I am hasn't changed. So
you're still able to go out and not get mobbed all the time, and you can, you know, go to the grocery store and sweats and all that kind of thing.
Absolutely.
Yeah. No, I think if you, you're the same person, and I mean, there are probably sometimes situations that you might not, you know, you might decide to not go, do or go into, but no, generally you're the same person, so it doesn't really change.
Now, I know Shay is a big fan of natural herbs and remedies and all that sort of thing. Did she give you anything on set or any advice? Or I read that you once gave a co-star deodorant that you made naturally. So just wondering if she imparted anything on you, any wisdom or tokens.
Who did you give deodorant to?
Herbs.
Ansel. I see.
She gave it to Ansel on set of Fault of Our Stars, right? So how about you, Theo? Did you get deodorant or anything from Shay?
No, luckily not that. Yeah, can you imagine that or toothpaste?
Theo wears deodorant, so I don't need to give that to him.
Smooth moves was a good tip from Shay.
When did I get you smooth move?
On set once.
Really?
Yeah. What is that for people who may not know?
It's a natural laxative.
Oh, okay. Keeping everything moving on set, making sure everything's regular and on time. That's hilarious. I think we're going to open it up for audience questions soon, but I've noticed that you both aren't on social media or your Twitter isn't super active. Why are you guys not into that?
I don't. It takes a lot of time, I think, to do
it's
that.
It's too busy.
Well, and also, I mean, you want to speak? I don't know.
I think we'd probably both, as you can tell, probably say inappropriate things anyway, and we get in trouble for it. Yeah. But no, it's like you want to keep a bit of a boundary, and different strokes is, you know, for different folks, but
that was a good one. Different strokes for different folks.
But it's nice sometimes to keep a boundary between work and your kind of your home life. Yeah,
I understand. I imagine that everybody watching this live streamed on the internet right now is super excited, because we don't always get to see you guys and hear from you guys, and it's live, and this is exciting. So I think we're going to open it up to some audience questions. I'm sure there's lots of things that people want to know. So does anybody have questions for Theo and Shay? They'll bring you the microphone.
Quickly.
We'll throw you one.
Hi, guys. Hi. I really love Divergent so much. You guys are great. Anyway, if life was really like Divergent, would you consider your character's decision rational?
In the second film or in the first film?
I'm sorry, in making a change. In both films, I guess.
Do you think the choices they make are rational?
Yes.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, Tris is a bit different, isn't she? I don't want to speak for you, but in the second movie, she is motivated by the death of her parents, so she's quite impulsive and she wants revenge. So in a way, for my characters trying to kind of stop that and kind of protect her from that impulsivity, because that's one thing that makes her, you know, very great and unique, but at the same time, she's kind of self-destructive. I think the other theme with Tris is this kind of idea of self-sacrifice. You know, it's this idea that she, which kind of the end of the final book always made sense to me, because her whole story is one of sacrificing herself for the good of others. The bit on the trailer where he jumps across the train was kind of funny, because people keep saying to me, so was that wires that, you know, you were on wires, right? And I'm like, no, I did it myself. I'm like, no, you couldn't do that, you loser. But yeah, no, so they just basically set up a piece of track and then I had to jump across it. It's not a great story, thinking about it.
So you guys did do some of your own stunts on set, though, yeah? That's very impressive.
Yeah, it's stunts are fun to do. You're sort of guaranteed safety, and they're exhilarating. You get a free adrenaline rush without much danger involved.
What have you guys learned from working together on the Divergent franchise from each other?
Learn a lot about British culture.
Such as?
I don't know.
Can you do a British accent?
My British accent sounds like Nanny McPhee. It's not. It's not a realistic British accent.
What have I learned from Shay? Self-love. Many things. You know, the nice thing about doing more than one film is that you get to know someone over a period of time, and you can kind of become proper friends instead of kind of, you know, because often when you do a film, you're kind of buddies quite quickly. You're fast friends, but doing this, you get to know people, meet her friends and family. I don't know why I looked over there, but hey. Yeah, so that's nice.
Well, that was actually a perfect lead into my next question, so thank you for that, Theo. I was going to say, you have great chemistry on screen, and was it easier the second time around because you already know each other and have that rapport together?
Yeah, I mean, I think that there's something to be said about what Theo just mentioned, which is when you have the luxury of doing a few films with someone, you do get to know them better and better, and your sense of trust for that person, your sense of respect for that person grows, and that definitely translates to our characters. You can obviously, if you don't have multiple films with someone, fake that and pretend that, but it is nice when you genuinely do respect the person that you're acting alongside.
Yeah, we kind of have a bit of a shorthand as well, because you do a second film and you've kind of gone through the first and learned some things from the first movie. So when, you know, when a scene wasn't feeling right or it wasn't sitting well, we could look at each other to say, you know, how should we fix this kind of thing.
It becomes teamwork, which is really nice.
You're also reteamed in this movie with Ansel Elgort, who we saw you with in Fault of Our Stars. In this movie, you're siblings. Do you prefer to play a couple, or brother and sister, or is it weird to switch?
At the same time, you like to do both.
Being a sibling and a lover. Kissing my brother. No, I mean, that's sort of the beauty of being an actor, is you get to jump into different roles and different shoes, wear different hats, and then take them off at the end of the day and try on another one.
Now, if either of you could create your own faction, what would you name it, and what sort of people would be in it?
Where is this broadcasting?
Where is what?
Well, what's the watershed? Is it like past midnight or something? Sorry. No, I was going to say something weird and dark.
Go ahead, say it. We're live on the internet, yeah. So.
Just one long beep.
You can curse.
What would... Can I?
Yeah, you can.
But now I'm scared to.
Good pressure.
No pressure.
Of cursing.
Well, I don't know. What would...
Or you could choose one that's already existing. I just thought you've probably been asked that before, and it might be fun to create your own. But you could pick one that they already have.
A music faction?
Yeah, music faction. Mm. Music and food faction.
That sounds good to me. Sign me up.